सहनावतु सहनौ भुनक्तु सह वीर्यंकरवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः। नमस्ते टू ऑल। We saw yesterday very important verse, verse number 3, talking about the equation between the Jiva and Ishvara, which is the crux of this knowledge, very beautifully put in the 3 lines by Acharya Totaka. With such finesse and precision. In fact, the Mahavakya is already precise. And then on top of that, you know, he has made it so tight. And the translation, I mean, if you just read the translation, it doesn't do any service at all to the purport of verse number 3. So it talks both about the preparation, cultivation of a mind that is free of all kinds of projections, both positive and negative, based on one's own preferences and prejudices. And it's a cultivation of already a relatively non-dual mind, non-judgmental mind, where the pressure to criticize something and the pressure to that pressure which is fueled by insecurity, whose cause is ajnanam, ignorance centered on the self. That was very beautifully described, when talking about the mind of Adi Shankara, which has been purified by Karma Yoga and which has been made radiant by Nijabodha Vichara Avichara, Nijabodha Vicharanena Charumate. So the one who has a beautiful mind, why? Because of the depth of the assimilation of the Nijabodha, self-knowledge, conducted through enquiry, Vicharana, self-enquiry and the ensuing self-knowledge has made that mind clear and beautiful. Please give me that kind of a mind, Kalaya, and make me a knower of Jiva and Ishvara as one. He Bhava Shankara, Oh Shankara, the one who makes people transcend samsara, Deshika, the one who indicates the oneness between Ishvara and Jiva, you are my only refuge. And this again, as we saw, the oneness, you know, people were asking, is this a concept? It's not a concept. The oneness is not a concept, it's you. It's you in connection with all your longings and cravings. You know, underneath all the longings and cravings is the only longing and the only craving to be one with everything, to be in harmony with everything. So it's not a concept. Oneness is not a concept. Oneness is a fact. It's the truth of one's nature. And oneness is not something to be accomplished. It is something that is infinite, limitless. It already is. It is to be discovered with the grace of the teacher and the teaching and of course the grace of Bhagavan, which is all one and the same. But for purposes of talking about it, we say, you know, Atma Kripa, Guru Kripa, all these things, you know, Shastra Kripa and Bhagavad Kripa, all these things we talk about it separately, separately, but it's all just one big grace operating to be able to see that the gold and the ornaments are one. And in fact, it is the gold that is sustaining the world of ornaments without undergoing any change. It manifests as the ornament and the ornament arises from gold and sustained by gold, goes back to gold, is resolves into gold. This is, you know, what we call one lakshana, one kind of an understanding of Ishvara from the standpoint of the Jagat. Because we have this vast Jagat to deal with, because we live in a manifest universe, you cannot dismiss the Jagat. And all contentions that Vedanta dismisses the Jagat cannot be sustained, must be dismissed. Because this is simply not true. Because we have to deal with the Jagat. And so one definition of Ishvara is from the standpoint of the manifest Jagat. And that's where we bring in all the ornament, gold pot, clay example, one clay, many, many pots, one gold, many, many ornaments. We can keep on, you know, we can keep on multiplying such examples, because they, you know, they all serve to indicate one thing, and one thing alone is that this one unchanging, unalterable, non-negatable consciousness is the truth of the Jagat. From this has come the whole Jagat. And then this means what here? Jagat Karanam Brahma. Brahman from the standpoint of the cause of the universe. So this is one kind of an indication of Ishvara. If there is Jagat, there is a maker of the Jagat, because you certainly don't call all the shots. You cannot change anything. At the most, you can fiddle with the thermostat in your room to increase the heat. That's all you can do when it is cold. And sometimes that also doesn't work. You can wear a sweater. That much you can do. But this is, you know, you know immediately that you are lorded by the universe. Universe means the universal laws. You are lorded by the laws of the universe completely. And that's why I was talking about that particular, what is that, you know, that particular verse, you know, where the man chants. Some roadside fellow is chanting. And what is he saying? Oh Lord, you and I are one. Oh, he must be a great jnani. Because he says, Aham tvacham tvam cha Rajendra Lokanatha Ubhavapi. You and I, oh Rajendra, Rajendra means God, name for God. You and I are both world lords. Oh, are you a jnani? No. Read the next line. Bahubrihi ahamasmi shashti tat purusho bhavan. So the world lord compound can be resolved in two ways. One is simple, lord of the world, that I am not. I am the other way of resolving the compound world lord, lorded by the world. So we are both world lords. The jiva is saying to Ishvara, you are the lord of the world. I am lorded by the world. I am overlorded by the world. So this is the apparent reality, which one believes in and which one takes it for granted, which one takes to be the reality. But here in verse number 3, we are goaded, we are pressed to the corner to be able to see the fallacy of the ways, because the an important lakshana of Ishvara is that the one from whom the Jagat has been as though projected, by whom the Jagat is sustained, unto whom the Jagat resolves, in whom the entire Jagat resolves. This is one indication, and this indication is called Tatastha Lakshana. An incidental definition of Ishvara, an incidental indicatory mark of Ishvara is that, is there a Jagat? Check. And if there is a Jagat, who is the Lord of the Jagat? Bhagavan. Check. This is one way of defining Ishvara. But then this is not this is an incidental definition. Just like, is there a pot? Yes. So there must be clay. That because without clay, there cannot be pot. But then this is just a partial definition, because as I pointed out earlier, the clay can live as a lump. The clay can live as many figurines, and the clay, you can make a Krishna figurine out of beautiful Krishna figurine from clay. You can make a lid. You can make 10 other pots. You can make a cup, a saucer, all these things. You can make all those things from clay. But clay is free of all those things. So then you know, but this so the existence of earthenware is just one definition of clay, because the second definition of clay is from its own standpoint, from its own inherent standpoint. Let us say it is brownish in color or whatever it is, you know, from which, you know, it is a intrinsically, it is a, you know, it is itself. And then incidentally, it manifests as earthenware. So the manifesting as earthenware, so Ishvara manifesting the Jagat and manifesting as non-separate from the Jagat is just one part of the definition. And then the other part is what? Ishvara as Satchidananda. See, now it is becoming very, very clear. So Ishvara as Satchidananda, Swarupa Lakshana. Just like the clay Swarupa, it has a certain volume, it has a certain weight, it has certain wetness, whatever it is. You know, those are its intrinsic properties. But here we cannot say Satchidananda is the property of Ishvara. You know, it is a essential Swarupa of Ishvara. So Ishvaratvam, you know, is what? Ishvaratvam is the, when we talk about removing Ishvaratvam and removing Jivatvam, we are only talking about Tatastha Lakshana. Please keep this in mind. We are not talking of Swarupa Lakshana, because the Swarupa is that which cannot be removed. Hello. Yeah, that is the meaning of Swarupa. So when you're trying to establish this Mahavakya and the oneness, when you're trying to see the oneness, and when you say, okay, this side remove Jivatvam, and then this side remove Ishvaratvam, you try to make it into an equation so that everybody understands. We are only talking about that which comes and goes alone can be cognitively removed, because the Jagat comes and goes. And if when the Jagat comes, the overlord of the Jagat also comes and has got a title, manifester. So if Ishvara had a mugshot, he would be holding manifester, resolver, guilty as charged. Yes. Why did you do this? Why did you manifest this Jagat? Well, you know, I am so blamed, guilty. So this is Ishvara's mugshot. Jiva's mugshot, miserable, because of this Jagat, miserable. So that miserable title is removed, because it comes and goes. I am attacked, removed. I am the manifester, removed. Unto me the Jagat resolved, removed. Why? Because the Jagat comes and goes. Jagat is not a fixture on top of Ishvara. Thank God. You know, it's just like these children that hang on to the mother's sari, you know, at 2 years the separation anxiety sets in. So they go wherever the mom goes. No, not like that. Yeah, so they're not like that. So, you know, even though we invoke Ishvara as the mother and the father of the universe, you know, this is not where the Jagat is, you know, catching hold of the dhoti of Ishvara or the sari of Ishvari. No. Ishvara is free of the Jagat. Tasya kartaram api mam vidhi akartaram avyayam. Beautiful. Fourth chapter, Bhagavad Gita. Chaturvarnyam maya srishtam gunakarma vibhagashah. The gradations in society, the hierarchies, even though it may seem very, what is that called? Unjust. It is full of injustice, were created by me. The setup was created by me, Arjuna. And then as Arjuna is preparing to take a mugshot of Krishna, oh, I'm going to put you behind bars. Why did you do this? Lord Krishna washes his hands off. Tasya kartaram api mam vidhi. Know me to this, to be the author of this. Akartaram avyayam, but my essential nature is akarta. I don't do anything, I don't project anything, and nothing resolves into me. Maya tatam idam sarvam, again in the ninth chapter. Jagadavyakta murthina machthani sarvabhutani. So he says, by me, this whole universe has been projected. In fact, I stretch out as the universe. Tanoti, tat, tan, to stretch. I stretch out as the universe. And then what? And my essential nature is avyakta. unmanifest is my essential nature, but somehow I manifest as the universe. Matsthani sarva bhutani, all these beings have their being in me. Swarupa lakshana, I am Satchidananda, these beings are also Satchidananda. And then the very next verse, he contradicts himself, as it were. Naja matsthani bhutani, pashyame yoga maishwaram. Bhuta brinnacha bhutastah, mamatma bhuta bhavanah. He contradicts himself. First he says, matsthani sarva bhutani, all beings have their being in me. There is only one being, Satchidananda Atma. I am Satchidananda, every being is Satchidananda. But don't think that if I say that everything has its being in me, that means there is one Ashrita, which is the Jagat, you know, refuging or locating in, located in me. Nothing is located in me. Nacha matsthani bhutani. There is no locator, there is no location. Because if there is a locator and location, what happens? There are two things. Dvaita comes, Advaita is not there at all. Advaita is not there. Only Dvaita is there. And so therefore what? So therefore, there is only one thing. And that one thing is Satchidananda Atma, incidentally wearing a crown on its head whenever there is Jagat in play. Wearing a crown on its head and playing God. Yeah, Satchidananda playing God. Like children play teacher, you know. They make all the adults sit down with a little, you know, stick or a ruler, and they tell them, sit down, do your homework, what is this? You know, whatever they get at school, they went out at home after putting a few adults in one place and playing teacher. So here Satchidananda wears a crown and plays Ishvara. Oh, you, your karma is gone. Oh, you were born under the wrong star. That's also because of your karma. Oh, you, I think, you know, since last time you really wanted to go to America. But unfortunately, this time you are born as a cow. Okay, we'll send you as a hybrid Jersey experiment. Go there. Your desire for America will be fulfilled, even though you won't be able to enjoy it. You know, some humor is there, something is there. And then, you know, so Satchidananda playing Ishvara. It's all a play. Atmaratihi, Atma Krida. It's very, very beautiful. All the Upanishads and the Bhagavad Gita talk about this. And then suddenly Satchidananda suddenly has kind of a, you know, sinking feeling. What happened? The crown on the head was replaced by the dunce cap. You don't know anything. You're an idiot. Dunce cap. And fear, something is coming at me. Help. Oh no. Not me. Why me? And Satchidananda is still playing that role. At this level is the unity. Where that dunce cap can be doffed off through Atma Jnanam, through approaching the teacher, through approaching the Shastra, taking Saranagati as it were in the Shastra, as though teacher, as though Shastra. But why as though? Because as though dunce cap. Because it all has to be on the same level of reality. The teaching is as though, because the dunce cap is as though. The belief that I am an idiot is as though. And so it is as though removed. Like a thorn removing another thorn. Like diamond cutting a diamond. Same order of reality. Okay? So then even here at the Ishvara's level, this Ishvara is playing. Okay, I'm sending you to America. Oh, you want to go to New Zealand? I don't know why, but okay, go. Another Jersey cow. Okay, New Zealand is also full of cows. Yeah. And then what? Oh, you want to be in India? Well, your karma doesn't allow it. So right now, so what we will do is make you an Indophile, but born in England. You know, all you'll only be wanting to eat curry, and you will make your parents very angry and go to satsangs at a young age and confuse everybody. Maybe you will start talking Sanskrit because of some previous punya. This is what happened. Somewhere, you know, this was a long time ago. Somewhere in the heart of Ohio, when you know, when child was born to an American couple, long time, 40, 50 years back. And I haven't followed the story after that, so I don't know the story. So then when child was born to an American couple, and he didn't speak till he was 2 or 3 years old, and they just thought maybe he's slow and everything. And when he talked, nobody could understand him. It was gibberish. And then finally they decided to take him to a psychiatrist because he was very animated when he talked. And then, you know, they thought, let us see, maybe say, well, what is happening here? Why is he not talking? And then they took him to a psychologist. And the psychologist said, even I don't understand him, but I do know he's speaking Sanskrit, because the psychologist was Dr. Patel. So he could understand that Sanskrit is being spoken by this child. Yeah. Some purva punya, wonderful, but along with the samskara of Sanskrit, the vasana of going to America and enjoying was stronger, and so that prevailed. So all this is the play of Ishvara. This is what is called tatastha lakshana. Tatastha lakshana, an incidental definition of Ishvara as the ruler of the universe, as the karma phala data, giver of the fruits of action, as the niyanta, the controller of all the laws, as the manifester of dharma, as manifest as dharma. This is just a one, you know, one, from one standpoint, an incidental definition of Ishvara, and then that incidental Ishvaratvam goes, but Ishvara stays, because the you know, the Ishvaratvam goes means when the Jagat is not there, there is no ruler. Like our Indian Maharajas, you know, they are just got titular head, and then they'll have some palace. The crumbly palace, poor things, they'll be living in the crumbliest portion, and the nice portion is a government 5-star hotel to show all the foreigners who come to Rajasthan how the kings lived. That's all it is. So they'll be living in a crumbly palace, a portion of the palace, and then they get some purse to maintain that so that it looks nice, get a paint job, you know, replace some stones that have gone missing from there. And then what, you know, and then some local functions are there, you know, camel festival in Rajasthan. What other festival can they have? It's fully desert. So camel festival of Rajasthan, where all I've been to one, and where all camel things, camel cheese, camel milk. Who is going to want to drink? I don't know, but the locals drink camel ghee, and then camel rides. And then camel something, you know, camel kick, because sometimes you go too close, it will kick also. So this is the camel festival. And then the Maharaja Adhiraj aa rahe hai, you know, the king of the king of the king of the king and the queen of the queen of the king are coming to inaugurate the camel festival. They're also on camels. Okay. Yeah. So then, you know, then it's small little thing. And the king gets down from whatever it is, you know, sometimes it comes in a, what is that? Comes in a two-wheeler, you know, very unceremonial. So this, you know, so when there is no Jagat, then there is no Ishvara, because what are you going to, that overlordship, no Ishvara doesn't mean no Ishvara. Satchidananda is there, but there is that role of overlordship has been taken away, because when there is no Jagat, there is nothing to overlord, there is nothing to create, there is nothing to sustain, there is nothing to resolve, there is no karma, there is no karma phala, there are no jivas, there is no helplessness, there is nobody praying, trahimam, pahimam, charanagatihi, all these things, nobody is praying. And so there is nothing to do. And at the level of there is nothing to do, walks in the Swarupa Lakshana, the inherent definition, the, you know, not the incidental definition, the intrinsic definition of Ishvara, Satchidananda. And again, if there is no Jagat, there is no Jiva holding the board called, I am miserable, help me, love me, take care of me, do something to me, I am dying. Board is gone because it's all one. Jiva is no longer the holder of the board. Jiva is no longer board, pun intended. and then Jiva is no longer gored by the tigers of the raga and dveshas and all kinds of scary things. There is in fact no Jiva. What Jiva is there? Jiva is only there as Satchidananda. At this level, the oneness takes place. Therefore, the unity that is described in the Upanishad is not between Jiva and Brahman, because that is already arrived at when you resolve that the truth of the Tvampada yields this Satchidananda. So the equation is between Jiva and Ishvara, because the misery is there. I am not Ishvara. That's why he quoted that verse. Lokanatha, Ubhavapi, we both are world lords. One small difference. You are the lord of the world. I am lorded by the world. It's the same compound, world lord. You know, even in English we have compounds like gas station. Station that dispenses gas. You know. And then, before this compound came into being, if during the time of the Holocaust you had said gas station, it would have been a totally different, unfortunate meaning. A place where people are gassed, eliminated, genocide. You see, same meaning or same thing. One is an innocuous place where gas is dispensed. Another is a different kind of a gas where people are killed. Masses of people, millions of people meet their death. This is a very different thing. So similarly, compounds are like this. And so this is not a small matter to see that out of these two kinds of lakshanas, the tattva lakshana, an incidental definition of Ishvara, a crown that is gained because of one's, what is that called? One's status. That at that level, the status we can see as removable. And then the Jiva status of being a miserable entity is also eminently removable. And then what? And then what is left is Jiva is Ishvara. There is only one. Ishvara, Ishvari, one. I am Satchidananda. That is just so gorgeous, so beautiful. So I hope that clears things. Otherwise, you can always ask some questions. Okay, yeah. Then, next one.
Bhava eva bhava niti me nitara samajayata chetasi kautukita mama varaya moha maha jaladhim bhava shankara deshika me sharanam bhava shankara deshika me sharanam.
So here he is eulogizing his teacher as Bhagavan. You, O Lord, are Bhava incarnate, he's telling the teacher. You, O Lord, are Bhava. Bhava means Lord Shiva. Bhava also means samsara, but here Bhava means the one who resolves everything. The one who, Bhagavan in the form of Samharakarta. Samharakarta means in the form of the great, the one who dissolves everything, the one who takes back everything that the Lord of that oneness, the one who makes samsara come to an end, whose grace makes samsara come to an end is called Bhava. So, Bhavaha eva Bhavan. Bhavan, you are Bhava incarnate. You are Lord Shiva incarnate. Nitaram iti me, iti means in this manner, knowing this, in this manner, nitaram always samajayata is born chetasi in my heart kautukita, a sense of great wonder. A sense of great wonder is born in my heart, O teacher, seeing you as an incarnation of Lord Shiva himself. Seeing that you are Lord Shiva, a sense of constant wonder is born in my heart. Or you can use the word constant slightly in a separate place. Both are okay. A sense of great wonder is constantly born in my heart. I am in the grip of a constant wonder. I am in a trance, O Lord. If I just think of you, I am in a total trance because I see you as the Lord always. And then, and so therefore what? Mama, for me, Varaya, remove, dispel, take away. What? Jaladhim, this ocean, take away this ocean, the Mahajaladhim, big ocean. Maha is great ocean, huge ocean, great ocean, endless ocean of what? Moha, delusion. Take away, O Lord, this great ocean of endless delusion for me. Why? Because as Lord Shiva, what are you supposed to do? What is your role as Lord Shiva? To take away. That is what you do. You are a samharakarta. You take away, you mop up everything that doesn't belong. And mop up this ocean of delusion for me. Mop up the ocean of delusion that is causing water damage in my antakarana. And what is that? All the raga dveshas in the form of fungi, mold and mildew are thriving because of this ocean of delusion. They are all thriving. And then what? And then the walls of Shraddha are flaking and falling because of the water damage of this ocean of delusion. The walls of Shraddha, Bhakti, reverence and devotion are falling. And the foundation of Shama and Dama are threatened. So this is a house that is a house of cards. I mean, if you go to Northeast India and places in Japan also where it is, prone to earthquakes, the house has to move. And because otherwise it will fall. The house is what has to move. So they make the house stand in such a way that it bends before it breaks. So this way here, you know, to stretch that metaphor, my house, the mind, the buddhi, the antahkarana, the inner instrument where I'm supposed to house this knowledge and house, discover that Ishvara is very much housed there. Ishvara is somewhere in a closet that is full of clutter outside and inside. And in and this clutter of raga and dvesha has to be removed in order to see this Bhagavan within me as my own indweller, as the indweller of my inner psyche, antahkarana. And then as I'm in the process of delittering this clutter, what has happened? an attack of the ocean of delusion. Because I had built this house close to the ocean of delusion. Because that's all I knew. I was deluded. Because all jivas have ocean view. What ocean? Ocean of delusion. That's what you see from the living room. That's what you see from the bedroom. That's what you see upon waking. That's the last thing you see before you sleep. Because one is born in ajnanam. Ajnanam means self-ignorance. Self-ignorance leads to delusion. And so born close to this ocean of delusion. And perhaps I built my house here because the mother had built her house here. The father had built her house. The great-grandparents were here. So I thought I'm carrying this lineage of ajnanam by building my house close to the shores of delusion. And sure enough, one intended, what happened? Inundated by the waves of self-loathe, inundated by self-critique, inundated by self-doubt. And I had tried very hard. I went to the teacher to take some, what is that called? Marie Kondo decluttering classes. This Marie Kondo is one lady, you know, yeah. So this Marie Kondo became famous. Last year or something like that. Suddenly nobody had heard of her. See, the meaning of the word condo for us was what you live in, condominium, short condo. But then this Marie Kondo suddenly came along, and this lady with all kinds of ecological solutions to everything, and everything should be sparing, and your house should look as though you have just moved out, even though you are living there. And she had some kind of a universal vastu system. And then you just put one little something out, that to what you need, and that has to be in the living room, or in, let's say, in the bedroom. There is a bedside table and one lamp. How boring! That's what everybody does. Remove the lamp. You don't need the lamp. Just use the overhead light. But then put some crepe paper on it so that it has some kind of an ambience. She taught all these things. And so she became very famous. But the fame was little short-lived, because then she started an internet shop, okay? An online shop of all the things you could do at home. You had to pay three times as much, and she got very rich because she sold one little paper with holes in them. How difficult it is. You just take a punch and keep punching. That's all you need. Take a one hole punch. You can buy it at any shop. And you can order it online also. And you keep punching, you have your holes. No, then she would, this holy paper, she would sell for thousands of, so much money she made. And she came under some criticism. And so then, this inner condo, no pun intended here. So the inner condominium of the mind, the heart, etc. I had exposed to the Marie Kondo treatment of trying to clean it up. And then what happened? A wave, a tsunami of delusion hit in the form of Viparita Bhavana. And then when it hit in the form of Viparita Bhavana, what happened? Everything collapsed. The walls of this house, already made unstable by samshaya, viparita bhavana, all these things. The nascent knowledge, if it was ever a reality, this nascent knowledge was severely threatened by the wet delusion, the ocean of delusion, by this wet delusion. And the tsunami, and then what happened to this tsunami? This tsunami threatened the Shraddha, and the mold and the mildew of Viparita Bhavana grew, doubt, despair, all these things. There is a certain quality of wetness to depression and despair. So all that grew, and then what? So instead of trying to declutter this house, in order, this inner house, to see the truth of the indweller as myself, to see, to have Ishvara Darshan within. And what did I end up doing? I ended up making the problem worse. I ended up making the problem much worse, because now, in addition to the clutter, I have water damage. But this is easy for you, O Lord. You are Lord Shiva, who makes things disappear, who made everything disappear. This is what it is. That's why you are covered in ashes and stripes. If I see you from far away, I don't know whether you are coming or zebra is coming. That many vibhuti stripes you have on yourself. You are full of vibhuti. And vibhuti means what? That which is reduced to ash. And then, the ash is a symbol of vairagya. The ash is a symbol of the ephemeral nature of this whole universe, which is reduced to ashes. Even in Christianity, we say ashes to ashes, dust to dust, same thing. They're reduced to ashes. And then, so that's why Lord Shiva means ash. One time a child asked me, what is the difference between Lord Shiva and Lord Vishnu? And I had just a few minutes. So I said, Shiva, ash. Vishnu, cash. That's all. That's the difference. Vishnu is symbolized by cash, because Lakshmi, married to Lakshmi, all, you know, all bhaga, all kinds of wonders. Vishnu is all cash. Shiva is the opposite, ash. She went away happy. So that is good. So this is what the whole thing is. Now, you as Lord Shiva, that's why he's invoking as Lord Shiva, because I don't want the cash, I want the ash. And then what do you want to do now? What I want you to do is just like you make things disappear, you reduce everything to ashes, reduce this ocean of delusion to ashes. That's why we wear the vibhuti, so that the delusion is reduced to ashes. Reduced, you know, jnanagni sarva karmani bhasmasat kurute tada. This chapter, Bhagavad Gita, you know, it, where it says the fire of knowledge, because that is the third eye of Lord Shiva, is yathartha darshanam, the fire of knowledge. He is called Soma Surya Agni Lochanaha. So he, you know, he is the one eye is the moon, one celestial body through which we see at night. The other eye is, of course, the sun, the other celestial body that predominates and makes sight possible during the day. But then Lord Shiva has a third eye. What is that? A fiery eye that reduces to ashes the subjectivity of raga and dvesha. The visual subjectivity is reduced. That's why in the story, Kama, we have a cupid, you know. Yeah, we have a cupid. And like an angel that has one bow and arrow. Same thing in the Western mythology also, there is one cupid. Here we call him Kama Deva. Our cupid is called the Lord of Desire. And he's married to a woman called Attachment, Ratihi. Appropriate, you know. It's a marriage made in heaven. Attachment and desire. And that's why they never fight. They get along very well. So Kamadeva and Rati, they keep going to see who they can attack. And they have, of course, same like Cupid, they have flowery arrows. And the flower arrow pierces the heart. One falls in love. Okay. Yeah. One falls in love. Falling is the operative word here. Falling means subjectivity. Falling means the vision is not clear. Falling means shobhana adhyasa. You see only the wonders of somebody. And oh, how nice. Oh, wow, how nice. Be mine forever. And then after that, get out of my sight. Because the scales of shobhana adhyasa fall. So, but this is what it is. And then Lord Shiva, you know, and then Kamadeva, Lord Shiva allowed Kamadeva to do his job in the world, because after all, that is what the world is about. The world is full of people falling and getting up. Sometimes they don't get up, but that's okay. Next life is always there. And then, you know, people fall and get up, fall and get up. This is the world. But one day, Kamadeva decided and dare to shoot an arrow at Lord Shiva, because he took it upon as a challenge. Maybe Rati made a bet with him and said, why don't you try this? Because he is impervious to anything. You can't even make him fall in love with a chocolate cake, let alone a person of interest here. So why don't you shoot an arrow at him and see what is going on over here? And then, so he just, with little shaky hands, he shoots the arrow. Shiva doesn't even bother to open the first two eyes. He's in meditation. He is meditating, reveling in the glory of Atmajnanam, which is himself. He just straight away opens the third eye, out of which fire comes and burns this Kamadeva. Burns him right in front of Rati, his consort. And that's how the story goes. The story is that for the one who is established in self, the metaphor is this, for the one who is established in self-knowledge, no subjectivity can attack, no arrows, no flowery arrows of subjectivity can attack and delude. And so Kamadeva is reduced to ashes. Rati comes and catches hold of to complete the story. No, yeah, Rati, Puranic story, and laden with metaphors, Rati comes and flings herself on Lord Shiva's feet, at Lord Shiva's feet, and says, "What have you done to my husband?" and everything. And then he resurrects him again back and says, "Okay, as long as Jivas are there, let them have fun. Maybe he can be of some service. Maybe he can teach people how to love whose hearts are hardened by samsara and by the water damage of, you know, where that callous lime scale has built up due to the water damage of the ocean of delusion. So they have to go in stages. First, they learn to love their one person other than themselves. Then they can love the whole jagat. Then they can understand themselves as the truth of the jagat. Okay, go in peace." He resurrects him back and then, you know, tells him not to direct his arrows at him anymore, or any jnani for that matter. This is what it is. And so like this, the ocean of delusion, this is what it is. And Lord Shiva symbolizes reducing that subjectivity, which is the truth of the ocean of delusion, to ashes. And then, you know, and ocean of delusion doesn't mean falling in love. It means falling in love with anything that is not worth it. Like cash, falling in love with a bank account, falling in love with real estate, falling in love with something because there is an inner insecurity which is strangulating the person. And instead of looking and attacking the inner insecurity, one tries to furbish the inner insecurity with some little lollipops in the form of a house, in the form of a bank account, in the form of stocks, bonds, etc. And that insecurity is like a fire. It consumes everything. Nothing happens. And so therefore, enter the third eye of discrimination, the third eye of objectivity, the third eye of vairagya, dispassion of Lord Shiva, that reduces this delusion to ashes. So that's why I am invoking you, oh Shankara, as Bhava Shankara. You, who is Lord Shiva for you? This is nothing. Look at how you reduced Kamadeva to ashes. Useless desires you reduced to ashes. And here I am being threatened to be engulfed by this Mahajaladhi. This big, great, endless ocean of delusion has entered my antahkarana, is threatening to destabilize little bhakti, little bit of shraddha, that little flame of mumuksha, desire to be free, that little glow of jignyasa, the desire for knowledge, is being extinguished as we speak. Come, mama varaya. Remove this ocean. Your the fire of your third eye has the ability to dry up this ocean. Notice here, he's not saying, you know, please teach me swimming lessons in this ocean of delusion. How to stay afloat. Give me a rubber lifesaver that I can put around my chest and bob up and down in the ocean of samsara, greeting other people also who are bobbing up and down in place. This is what happens. You should know what to pray for. And this is how we learn. Because if you say that, give me a lifeboat, give me a life, what is that? Life jacket. Upon contact with the water, a light will come on, a blinking light. This is what we are told when we sit in the plane. The life jacket will be in a little pouch under the seat in front of you. When instructed, remove it, put it on. And then when you're outside the plane, blow into the tubes for it to be inflated. And don't worry if the light doesn't come on. It is automatically designed to come on when in contact with the water. Here the heart is going puk, puk, puk. Even the thought of a life jacket But then there is a strange, in this morbidity, there is a strange satisfaction. Oh, at least it is there under the pouch is under the couch. So some kind of a thing is there. Even though the heart is saying, ouch, ouch, you know, there is some happiness that under the couch in front of you, there is a pouch. Even though it is not going to get rid of your anxiety right now. This is what the whole thing is. And so he's not praying for the life jacket. The life jacket is a temporary measure. That's why it doesn't give that calm, even though it's supposed to be there. All these fears come, what if it is torn? When was it checked last? Because the plane comes, the plane goes. And what if it has, all the plastic has just stuck together? You know, because it is me and my prarabdha has not been very good. What if I can't open it? All these things, these fears are there. And life jacket means you are permanently there in the ocean of samsara. You just learn some swimming lessons. And this is what happens to Mirabai also. Mirabai goes to the guru and says, oh my God, I'm inundated by the ocean of sorrow and delusion. Quick, do something. And then, you know, what does the guru say? Guru says, you know, she says, Bhavasagar sab sukh gaya hai. Sukh gaya hai means the guru's, the warm glance of the guru's compassion has completely dried up this ocean of samsara. And everything that is dependent on the ocean, the alligator is taking its last breath. The seaweeds, which would have engulfed me, are dying. All the sharks, and the, you know, full of jaws and three rows of teeth. You know, I don't know why Bhagavan made it like that, but it has three rows of teeth, up and down, both. You know, this is what it is. And then, you know, when it loses the teeth, before the teeth is lost, the new tooth grows and puts this teeth out of commission. Puts this tooth out of commission. That's how it operates. So, very, very interesting. So, the water world, the water world of all kinds of things, the things that depend on this ocean of delusion, like lack of shraddha, loss of confidence, insecurity of, insecurity in the form of the sharks and big things that are there, stingrays, eels, and the doubts of, what is that called? The seaweed in the form of doubts, riptide, undercurrent. So the whole thing that depends on this ocean of delusion is also destroyed. The whole samsara is destroyed with one look of the teacher, the look of the pramana. When pramana looks at you, the ocean is destroyed. And then the same thing is there. You know, this is a very wonderful metaphor, and it is repeated because it is so taking. It is so touching. This metaphor is repeated in the Advaita Makaranda. Kataksha kirana chanta naman mohabdhaye namaha. Here, moha jaladhi, there mohabdhi, same thing. So, I'm invoking that teacher whose warm glance, kataksha, by the corner of the eye. This is where, when you look from the sidelong glance, that is kataksha. Whose kataksha, whose sidelong glance has the power of sipping up the entire ocean of samsara to the ones that have taken refuge in the teaching. Amazing. So the ocean of samsara, here the author, Totakacharya, knows very well it is a notion of samsara. And this is something to note because he's not taking the ocean of samsara seriously. He is calling the bluff, and therefore he's not asking for swimming lessons. Asking for swimming lesson means give me money, you know, keep this one okay, make that one okay. Give me money, give me this, give me that. This is what everyone's regular prayers are. And if one is only praying for things in the universe, that is, you know, to give one, what is that called? The children wear, no, one little life thing here to in the kiddie pool. You know, you send them with this little armband, which inflatable armband. Give me something to inflate. You know, already my, what is that? my investment in samsara is already inflated. Keep it that way. Keep my subjectivity alive. Oh Lord, keep me going. Keep me flapping around. Why? Because everybody else is doing that. Now, if you reduce samsara to dust, what will happen to the other swimmers? This is all an endless delusion. So remember, like Totaka, never ask for swimming lessons. You know, ask for the samsara ocean. Unlike Totaka, don't ask for swimming lessons. Yeah. So just don't ask for swimming lessons. Like Totaka, ask for the samsara ocean to be reduced to ashes for you. That is what the whole thing is. This is what it is. Because if we keep swimming in samsara, it's an endless swimming. Glub, 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 glub. Mundaka Upanishad also says this. Plavaheta adrida yajna rupaha. Yajna rupaha plavaha adridaha. So if you craft a raft, if you craft a raft of punya karma, good karmas, you stack all the good karmas together and tie them with some thread, and then you go adrift in the ocean of samsara, the good karma will only last this long and the raft will come apart. The raft will rot, because that is why it's called karma phala. The word phala, phalgutaya liyate, that which is subject to rotting is called fruit. This is what the whole thing is. And so therefore, don't ask to swim. Don't ask for the ocean to be rid of sharks, because ocean will have sharks. Don't ask for there to be a boat, or a chariot to be rescued. Ask for the ocean itself to disappear like the very notion it is. Ask for the bluff of the ocean to be called and for the ocean to be reduced to a notion. He Bhavashankara, he Deshika, me Sharanam. Next one. Sukrate dhikrate bahudha bhavato bhavita samadarshana lalasata atidinamimam paripalayamam Bhavashankar Deshika me Sharanam. Bhavashankar Deshika me Sharanam. Another wonderful verse where his humility is very evident. His humility and his attitude, this prakvi bhava, his attitude of surrender in relation to the teacher is very evident. So, bhavataha, we have to take bhavato, bhavataha, your what? You know, your grace, that grace is not there, we have to supply that. So, bhavataha anugrahena, through your grace, that anugrahena, we have to kind of infer that. Sukrataha adhikrataha bhavet bhavita. Yeah, sukrataha adhikrataha bahudha bhavita. So, we can take it like that. And then, so what does this mean? By you, by your grace, what happens? Sukrita. Kritam, done. Sukritam, well done. Sukrita means good karma, punya, punya karma. By you, your grace has the effect of magnifying the karma phala. So if there is a tiny, mustard seed worth of good karma I have done in this or other lives, what does your grace do? Put a magnifying glass on that mustard seed to the extent that it looks like a mountain. This is the power of your grace. The power of your grace magnifies the punya. Has the power to magnify the punya. Your grace magnifies the punya adhikrite. And when the punya magnifies, absolute locative construction, sukrite adhikrite, what happens? Bahudha, and then as it magnifies in all, Bahudha means Vistarena, in all different directions this good karma goes. And because of this good karma, I gain the ability to be a qualified student of Vedanta. Without this good karma, the qualifications for the study of Vedanta do not come. They do not come at all. And then, so what do I have to do? So I have to understand that, there is a connection between punya and the fructification of the punya and the gain of the guru and the internalization of this knowledge. There is a connection. Sukrite adhikrite bahudha. Bahudha means in great measure, in all directions. So when the punya increases, bhavata, bhavatah means by your grace, by you, when this punya increases, bhavita will become in the future. He says, I'm not even an adhikari. Bhavita, as I said, very frantic future. Later on, it will fructify bhavita. What will become? Samadarshana lalasata. Lalasata, a great longing, samadarshana, oneness. A great longing for the vision of oneness will be fructified in the future thanks to your grace, which magnifies my punya, which makes my punya greater and greater. How does the grace magnify the punya? Grace cannot magnify the punya. What do you mean the grace magnifies the punya? Grace magnifies the punya means that this, this is all we understand it through karma and karma phala. If I do a little bit of service, the guru kripa, the kripa of the guru, the grace of the guru, is so the here kripa means the compassion of the guru is so great, and the guru is so forgiving that all the good karma is only seen. The guru doesn't see anything bad. So the bad things that I may do have become non-existent because the guru only looks at the good things. Unless, of course, it's a teaching situation and the student needs to be taught. The guru looks only at the wonderful things. And then the more the guru validates the good behavior and the good karma of the students, the greater is the impetus for the student to do more good karma. Correct? The guru says, shabash, very good. And then what happens? And the student feels like doing more and more of that which earned the teacher's validation. So the teacher validates good karma. And so the student is hereby inspired. The student is inspired. And so that is one way in which the good karma increases. Because once you go to Vedanta, you study dharma, you study all these things, and then the desire to be a qualified student with the help of the teacher's grace makes one fall in line. And so it is a gift that keeps giving. The guru's grace is a gift that keeps giving. The guru's grace also gives adhikaritvam along with the knowledge, bestows the gift of adhikaritvam. Of course, one has to be open to it. Adhikaritvam means the qualifications needed for the study are also given. So that is the first meaning. Second meaning is that, it is a specific, this is general to all students of Vedanta. The second meaning is specific to Totakacharya, who was very much in service of Adi Shankara. He was washing his clothes, he was cooking for him, he was doing that kind of a close seva to the guru, which he said that is bringing more punya than anything else. Because why is that bringing more punya than feeding people, let's say, at a homeless shelter? Both are some kind of a reaching out action, purta karma. But then we hear that annadanam is
even though it is called param danam, annadanam is param, meaning it is a very good way of doing karma. Feeding somebody that's hungry is a most exalted karma, but not as exalted as vidyadanam, not as exalted as the giving of knowledge, especially the knowledge of the self. Why? Because annena, the food gets digested in 2 hours or less, and the person is left hungry. And with the donation of vidya, when you nurture somebody with the diet of Atma Vidya, they are purna, they are filled forever. That's why vidya danam is atiparam. Even beyond annadanam is vidyadanam. And this being the case, when this knowledge of the self is held in such high esteem, because it makes one discover that fullness where there is no more hunger, no more lack centered on the self. Whereas food gets digested and the desire to eat again comes. Here, once you eat this vidya, there is nothing more left to eat, nothing more left to greet. All finished. Krita krityoham dhanyoham. I am full. Nothing more to pursue. Where it is mangalam shubham, the end of the pursuit. And so for an exalted teacher to do seva to a teacher like Adi Shankara, to bring him his books that he needs, to polish his glasses if he ever wore them, and to wash his clothes, and to bring him his food, is indirectly, in fact directly even, helping him to teach. Correct? So keeping the guru healthy, keeping the teacher intact is very much needed for the dissemination of the knowledge, because the teaching is centered on the teacher. No teacher, no knowledge. And a sick teacher, no knowledge. So therefore, you know, to keep the teacher in good health, to take care of the needs of the teacher, he says, I am so blessed, my punya account, I keep looking at the dividends every day. It's multiplying, it is quadrupling as we speak, it's doubling, quadrupling, it is just increasing day by day. Why? Because I'm in service of you, who is in service of the whole universe. Your job is to bring people the knowledge of moksha. My job is to wash your clothes. But still, because of your grace, the lowly act, the mundane and the dispensable act, because if I don't wash your clothes, somebody else will come to wash your clothes. There'll be a long line of people. You'll have to put a lottery for the clothes washer. And if I don't wash your clothes, I'm doing a dispensable job. But because this job, this dispensable, lowly, mundane job, it is connected to the indispensable Atma Vidya that you embody, I am greatly blessed. And also I am blessed because my punya is increasing. You know why? Third reason. My punya is increasing because my papa is decreasing. How is my papa decreasing? Because I am in close contact with you. You look at me, I give you all this, I fold your clothes and iron it by hand and then present it to you. Oh Guru, here are your clothes, please wear them today after bath. And then you are constrained, because after all we are operating in a manifest universe. You are constrained to look at me and you smile at me. And of course that makes me feel wonderful when you look at me and smile at me. But there is something bigger happening. What is that? That each time you look at me, all the karmas, right, the last verse, are getting reduced to ashes. Bad karmas are getting reduced to ashes. So that means the good karmas are burgeoning and coming to the fore. Third reason why my sukrita is increasing, because the dushkrita is decreasing. How beautiful this verse is. That was just so grand. So three reasons he gives. One is the general reason. The general reason, the general premise, that in order to study Vedanta, you need good karma. You need to do good karma because all these other hijacking tendencies are there in the form of lurking raga dveshas that can take away somebody from the knowledge. So you pray for the knowledge, the desire for the knowledge to be intact, so that suddenly you don't turn away from Brahman. Turning away from Brahman is turning away from yourself. So you pray to be plugged into this knowledge always. And that creates the prayer, creates good karma, and because of the good karma and the grace of the teacher who wants you to study, that intention of the teacher also joins your good karma and multiplies it. First reason why good karma is multiplied. Second reason is because he is in service of the teacher who is doing Atma Vidya Danam, who is in service of Atma Vidya, and so Atma Vidya being the ultimate donation, the ultimate thing you can do to somebody, the ultimate help you can render to somebody, is to show them that they are not helpless, that they don't need any help at all. This is not a salvific tradition. Helping means knowing, not even asking you to help yourself, seeing that you don't need any help. That you are the Nitya Shuddha Buddha Mukta Atma. You are a free Atma which is all knowledge, all glory. And the only thing that there is, what help will you need? No help at all. And then that, to show that, is the ultimate help. And then since you are showing that, that is the second reason why, you know, the why this happens. Why the adhik sukrita becomes adhikrita? Because I am in service of you. So anything I do to help you teach is increasing my punya. And then just to repeat, just to sum up, the third reason is that I am in service of you. And when that means I have close proximity with you, whenever you look at me, even a look, a sidelong look, a smile, an interaction, then because of this service, what does this interaction do? The interaction has the power to burn up the wrong karma. Burn up the effect of the dushkritas, the papa in my life, so that the punya naturally multiplies. And so then what happens? Samadarshan. So then what will happen? Please do this for me quickly so that I become a qualified student for Vedanta. He says, I am not Sureshwara, look at that student, Sureshwaracharya, whose head is completely buried into the manuscripts, into the palm leaf manuscripts. In fact, he looks like a leaf himself, and he's become one with the manuscripts that he is studying. I told you he was a postdoc. Look at Padmapada, very much in service of you, protective of you, and then he has so much Shraddha, he can walk over the water in order to reach you. That's why he's called Padmapada. He just, Adi Shankara was sitting on one bank of the river and he called him, and then without even seeing how river deep the river was or how many alligators, he just walked across, and wherever his foot came, a lily pad arose to break his fall into the water. Padmapada. And look, and Hastamalakiya, he only talks Vedanta, and and here is lowly old me. I need all the help I can get. I'm not like your other students. They are maybe adhikaris. They are all, exalted adhikaris. I am just yet to gain adhikaritvam. But with your grace, with your help, and with your giving me opportunities for more and more service, I will be qualified in the future. I will be qualified. And then what? Ati dinam imam. He's referring to himself as imam, not mom, imam, this creature, this lowly creature who cannot hold a candle to other students. Ati dinam imam, paripalaya, please protect me all round, paripalaya mom. And this is what it is, you have to, he asks for protection, not from tigers and lions or any other things in samsara, protection from the ocean of delusion. Erect me a wall of the Upanishads so that I'm fortified, by my knowledge, so that the ocean of delusion just laps against the wall and goes away, does not attack me. and atidinam, I am so helpless. You know, then it is, we have a saying, the squeaky wheel gets the oil. So here, you know, if a mother has 3-4 children and one of them is very vulnerable and delicate and always falling sick, and the other one can eat a stone and nothing happens to it, naturally her, you know, her tendency will be going, her attention, everything will be going to the vulnerable one. So he says, I am at risk, I am most at risk from my own delusion. I have the most ragas, the most dveshas, because I am not qualified for this knowledge. Please, you have to help me, because the most vulnerable one needs the help. Oh mother, oh father, oh guru, help me come out of this vulnerability. He Bhava Shankara, he Deshika, me Sharanam. ॐ पूर्णमदः पूर्णमिदं पूर्णात् पूर्णमुदच्यते पूर्णस्य पूर्णमादाय पूर्णमेवावशिष्यते. ॐ शान्तिश्शान्तिश्शान्तिः. हरिः ॐ श्रीगुरुभ्यो नमः. हरिः ॐ. Any questions are there, you can ask, you can unmute yourself and ask, or you can write in the chat pod. Jiva is equal to Ishvara, a statement about resolving Jiva into Ishvara like a wave resolves into the ocean. Presumably a statement for the purposes of removing Jiva's alienation from the whole, or does it go all the way to the Swarupa of each side of the equation? Jiva is equal to Brahman. Yeah, but that Brahman is Ishvara, Chris. Yeah, there is no Brahman which is not Ishvara. So that's why we don't say Jiva is Brahman. Even though there is a sentence in the Brihadaranyaka Upanishad which says Aham Brahmasmi, that Brahman, if we read Adi Shankara's commentary there, it is very clear that Brahman is Ishvara, because there is no Ishvara other than Brahman. There is no Brahman other than Ishvara. The two are one. Now the question is this Brahman, is this Ishvara endowed with the incidental qualification of being the overlord of the Jagat or not? That is the key here. And if that is if you say yes, this Brahman is Ishvara because he's overlording over the universe and the Jiva is the one who is overlorded, then the lorded and the Lord are one. That is the Mahavakya. And in order to accomplish this Mahavakya, or order to unfold or unpack the Mahavakya, you remove that which is incidental and catch on to that which is inherent. And that which is non-incidental or non-negatable from the Tvam side, let us not call it Jiva anymore, from the You side of the equation, from the Tvam side, is all the accoutrements of Jivatvam, such as I am miserable, I am an idiot, I am vulnerable, all these things, I am insecure. Remove that, because already you know it comes and goes. In sleep you are not insecure, in sleep you are not, you don't consider yourself an idiot. So remove that. Remove insecurity, remove idiocy, and then all that you get is Sachidanandam Brahma. Sachidananda, which is the witness of all the states of the body, mind, and the witness is unaffected by what it witnesses. So Atma, that unaffected witness is derived, and that and then on the Ishvara side, remove the Jagat cognitively, remove the whole thing, the overlordship, the six bhagas, etc. And then what do you get? Sachidananda. That is what is there. So here the truth of the Jiva, the truth of you is Sachidananda, the truth of Ishvara is Sachidananda. At this level of Swarupa Lakshana, the equation operates. The equation cannot operate at the level of Tatastha Lakshana, because at the level of Tatastha Lakshana, the differences are apparent and here to stay. That is what it is. Until the Jagat resolves, and then after that it doesn't matter, because you are not there to see the difference. You are one with that. So Jivatvam is resolved by Atmajnanam, which which sees the spoof of Ishwaratvam, the only one side of Ishwaratvam is removed, that is that incidental, the power laden Ishwara. So we don't say Jiva is equal to Brahman because, you know, there is no Brahman other than Ishwara. And Western academics, you know, there is one book somebody wrote, Adi Shankara was confused. He passes the judgment. You know, Adi Shankara was confused whether Brahman is Ishwara or Brahman is Brahman. He was not confused. He was definitely talking about this. There is only one thing, and that thing is Ishwara, because we are having this discussion in a manifest universe. That is why the whole thing, we are seeking the knowledge, because we are in a manifest universe which includes in it the duality, which includes in it the so-called alienation. The spoof of the duality and alienation is called, because there is nothing to remove. The jiva is not alienated. The alienation is an as though superimposition, which is as though removed by the as though Upanishad study with an as though guru, by a jiva pretending to be a student. That's really what it is. And that's why the last verse, the one before this, that we studied, is very important, because he doesn't take the ocean of sorrow to be real, the ocean of delusion. He says, remove it, because he doesn't say, help me to navigate, give me an GPS for the ocean of samsara. He doesn't say that. He says, remove this notion. So when you see that, when you see the notional aspect of this, the notional truth of the alienation, the sorrow, etc., then that notion has to be warded off, for which only knowledge, because it's not real, it's mithya. It's not unreal either, because it is experienced. So it is mithya, it is that which is between real and unreal. It cannot be categorically affirmed nor absolutely denied. Hope that was clear. Yeah. Is Bhrantija Tadatmya? In Bhrantija Tadatmya, what is the Sakshi's role? The Sakshi's role is to see the Bhranti, and is not to roll into the one who is Bhranta. That is the thing. Because even when it is the Sakshi who says, I am ignorant. That is what it is. When you say, I am ignorant, you are actually all knowledge looking at a particular manifestation of ignorance. That's what it is. Nice questions, both of them. Anything else? Okay. All the best. Take care. See you all tomorrow. Om.
Om.
Om, om, om. Be well. Yeah, take care.
Thank you, Swamiji.
Om, om.
Thank you.
Om,
om. Om, namaskar. Nice to see everybody.